But I want to get right down to business today because I know that one reason that many of you are here is our wonderful keynote speaker today, Dr. Alessio Fasano, one of the world's leading experts on celiac disease, gluten sensitivity, and everything else related to those topics. I had the pleasure of hearing Dr. Fasano speak last year at the International Celiac Disease Symposium in Chicago and immediately knew, wow, this guy has the greatest combination of knowledge and a way of presenting it engagingly that is really deep scientifically and at the same time understandable to people who may not have that scientific background. So this is definitely the place to start. Those of you who were here yesterday heard Anna Sortun, one of our chefs, saying, I wish we could just get to the bottom of this gluten thing. Well, guess what? That's what we're here for today. As close as we can get. We won't get them all solved by 5 o'clock today, but we're gonna take a big chunk out of the unknowns on this whole topic. Dr. Fasano, a pediatric gastroenterologist, research scientist, and entrepreneur, directs the Center for Celiac Research at MassGeneral Hospital for Children. He's also a visiting professor of pediatrics at Harvard Medical School and the author of Gluten Freedom. So let's welcome Dr. Fasano, who will answer some of the key questions of this conference, such as what is gluten? What's with it? Who should avoid it? Why is celiac disease on the rise? Dr. Fasano.
Thank you, Cynthia. Thank you. Good morning, everybody. Indeed, I've been put on this really unfair and awful task to, talk about gluten now that it's so popular and try to be as factual as possible. And matter of fact, the objective of what I'm going to do in these 45 minutes is really to go through what are our evidence starting from, this paradigm that we start the entire business that it takes gluten as an environmental trigger. It takes the genetic predisposition to really have the recipe for celiac disease. And actually, we learned that it's not that the case. The situation is much more complicated, and eventually, celiac disease is one of the forms that you can react to gluten. But once again, when it takes out of context, this stuff goes totally out of control. And for that reason, I really want to spend a little bit of time really to discuss, about some of the basics, about this environmental trigger for which, again, there's been no much factual evidence out there. Discuss a little bit about the battlefields are in the gut. After all, I'm a pediatric gastroenterologist, so I'm a little bit centered around the gut. The rest of the body is just, stuff that may not need to be there. And how, for example, this, microbiome, the non-nutritionally speaking, is becoming such important things in the clinical outcome. And just because, again, I'm a gastroenterologist by training, I really want, you have, understanding and expertise in the world of nutrition, I want to make some points that are not very clear to us. Until the recent past, and that's really object of confusion, the gut was considered to be a sort of a magic tube in which you put food on the top, poop comes in the bottom, and in between there are this, stuff that comes through. So we have calories and energy and so on and so forth. True. This is one of the functions, but does many, many other things. So much so that even experts in the field, they have really hard time to give the right definition of what the gastrointestinal system is. Some people say this is the second brain. Personally, I believe that it's the first brain because there are more neurons in the gut than in the brain itself. It's the largest immune organ that we have in the body and so on and so forth. So it's complicated. That's the bottom line. The best definition comes from one of my students. She's a second grader, so forget about the spelling. The intestine is a long tube with a clean open on the top and a dirty open on the bottom. This is the quintessential of what we're going to discuss today. I don't want to talk about this. I asked her, what is this fish? And she said, that's the noise that my dad makes from the dirty hand quite often. All right, so, but seriously speaking, the father of all physicians, Hippocrates, again, wise man, already knew that all the disease begins in the gut. And this was a statement that he made long time ago. And again, as Cynthia was mentioning, I just had this book to set the record straight. One of my favorite quotes, Because I revisited the concerts, the gut is not like Las Vegas. What happened to the gut? Does not stay in the gut. And I will explain what I mean for that, because again, the intestinal mucosa, this long tube, is truly a battlefield in which friends and foes needs to be distinguished all the time. Of all the interface that we have with the environment, this is the most important, where this decision-making process happens 100 times a day. Imagine what kind of travesty if we made the wrong decision. I decide to get the friends out of there, meaning nutrients, we would die of starvation, or allow enemies, potential bacteria that can harm us, to really fight, not fight against them, and then have them to have access to our body, and what would be the tremendous consequences? So this balance of this decision that happens all the time, that is really, really important to maintain a state of health. And celiac disease is the ideal paradigm to understand what kind of mistake can happen when you take a friend that becomes a foe. Because after all, gluten is supposed to be a protein in a foodstuff, so a nutrient is good for us. But for a subgroup of individuals, it turns to be something that can put them out of commission. So let me put this in context to start with celiac disease. Celiac disease was described long, long time ago. But connection between celiac disease and gluten as the culprit celiac disease is something extremely recent, thanks to this Dutch pediatrician that made a very, very interesting observation. Again, history, for those that don't know the history of celiac disease, is the following. Celiac disease was a pediatric condition until the recent past. Mainly kids were affected. Was a disease with high morbidity and very high mortality. 30-35% of kids would die of celiac disease before that this guy made this observation. And would die because of malnutrition. Despite that they were eating, they were wasting what they were eating, and therefore they would not be able to survive. The destiny of these kids, indeed, was somebody would diagnose them with celiac disease, brought to the hospital, the hospitalist would confirm the diagnosis, say, leave the kids over here. Come back in 6 months, and if he or she is still alive, you can bring that back. And during these 6 months, these kids were fed only exclusively bananas. That's the reason why they are called the banana babies. What this fellow observed was during World War II, when there was shortage of wheat, and therefore flour was made with the potato starch, the mortality went to zero. And research faced to 30-35% after the war was over, when wheat was reintroduced in the European market. So he linked the two things and did an experiment. Now it's laughable because nobody will accept anything like this. It took six kids, put down a gluten-free diet, the symptoms went away, put these kids back on a regular diet, the symptoms came back, and had how he made the link between celiac disease and gluten-containing grains as culprits. This is still the backbone of what we do right now in terms of treatment of celiac disease. Now, fast forward in 2014, what is this? It's not a pediatric condition anymore. It's not true that you have to be Caucasian, very fair skin, a cousin of Santa Claus because you need to be North European to develop celiac disease. It's not true that, it's an allergy or sensitivity. Is a true autoimmune disease. It's like having diabetes, MS, rheumatoid arthritis, and so on and so forth. And as such, it's a recipe with some ingredients. The ones that we were aware of was the genetic component. The genetic component that, particularly these genes that we call HLA genes, the one that we use to establish histocompatibility when we have to do transplants, those genes, particularly this HLA, DQT, DQ8, are a must. You've got to have there to develop celiac disease. Without those, you cannot develop it. And it's another peculiarity about celiac disease. Similar genes are present in other autoimmune diseases, but not with such penetrance. The alloantigen, that is this enzyme that's called tissue transglutaminase, is known. As a matter of fact, the antibodies against it, it's the most robust test that we have for screening of an autoimmune disease out there. But what makes celiac disease unique is that the environmental trigger is known. We don't know why people come down with the other autoimmune diseases. Undisputably, is gluten the trigger of autoimmunity. As a matter of fact, when you put these people on a gluten-free diet, unless they develop complications, the symptoms will go away, the autoantibodies go away, the autoimmune insult that characterizes the disease, i.e. destruction of the intestine, is gone. So these people are totally undistinguishable from Josh Moe's out there. So, and this is based on a diet, okay? Now, when we were thinking about celiac disease, again, going back to Dickey's time, that's what we had in mind. That was the prototype of celiac disease. Kids that looks like the malnourished kids of the third world country that we see now. Big belly, subcutaneous fat gone, muscle wasting, irritability, see how happy stuff these kids are, was a trend mark of these kids. They look like this, again, not because they don't have food like the kids from the third world country now. They look like this because they were able to eat whatever they want, but just would go through, because the intestine were so destroyed that digesting and absorbing the foodstuff was impossible. Now, we do not see this at all. If we see anybody in our clinic with this, we take our iPod, iPhone, iSomething, and we take a picture immediately, because this is not what celiac disease is all about. As a matter of fact, the confusion that led to the consideration that celiac disease were rare in the United States, because we are looking at this. That's not celiac disease. This is what celiac disease. And again, this is really goes back to the concept that the gut is not like Las Vegas. The battlefield is there. The soldiers, i.e. the immune cells that fight against gluten, are on the battlefield. And they, when they see the enemy, they shoot weapons that create collateral damage that we call inflammation. When these soldiers, they stay put in the gut, you have the classical presentation of celiac disease with the picture that I showed you before. But sometimes, for a reason we don't understand, these soldiers, these immune cells, once harmed, i.e. programmed against gluten, they can leave the intestine and go somewhere else. They can go to the skin and you develop dermatitis piriformis. They can go to the bones and produce an autoimmune process there together with low iron, low calcium and vitamin D, leading to osteoporosis and so on and so forth. And again, it can go to the joint and create inflammation there and so on. So in other words, there is no single organ or tissue that is spared by this inflammatory process. Long story short, this is a clinical chameleon, and that's the reason why it's been so, so difficult to really to pinpoint what celiac disease is all about, how frequent it is, and why the United States was spared, at least that's what we thought before, about celiac disease. And now we know that this is a global village. It's 1% worldwide, no matter what you're talking about, okay? Even in China, with the modernization of the diet now, i.e. the advent of the McDonald's and the Kentucky Fried Chicken coming to Tiananmen Square, they start to see this penetrant celiac disease at the same percentage that the rest of the world. So what we learn over these years, what is the recipe to develop celiac disease as peculiarity compared to other conditions? Again, definitely you have to have the environmental trigger. Definitely you have to have the genetic predisposition that makes the immune system to act inappropriately. But also there was a third element that was not clear to us, the loss of barrier function of the intestine. The intestine is covered by a single layer of cells. There is a formidable barrier against the uncontrolled passage of stuff from the outside of the world. Consider the gut that is long 20 feet. In an adult, it's like a double tennis court, 3,000 square feet of surface. It's the largest interface that we have with the world. And this interface is really instrumental to protect us against this uncontrolled passage of enemies that can really put us out of business. And this is done by a single layer cell. So to make a comparison, imagine the body as a medieval city or a castle, and you have this wall around the city, the castle, that protects us against these enemies. So nobody can come in unless you want to. And in order to have these people to come in, you have gates that come down to allow good stuff to come in, merchandise and friends, but when they come in, you close the gates so the enemies that want to attack the city or the castle will have a hard time really to do that, because everything is protected by this wall. So that's the concept. Now, these gates, that we technically call tight junctions, sometimes in people without immunity, including celiac disease, are stuck open, so they go down and they can come back up again, and that allows the uncontrolled passage of this non-self antigen that can lead on a specific genetic background to celiac disease. why gluten is toxic. And this is one of the misconceptions. I want to tell you guys, when we start this, you know, journey almost 20 years ago at the Center for Celiac Research, we had other fish to fry. Nobody knew about celiac disease. Nobody knew about the gluten-free diet. The products were awful because there was no market. And therefore, we decided to start this crusade to increase the awareness of celiac disease. Sadly, we were so darn good that this went out of control. So the pendulum went all the way to the other hand, mainly because some people took this science that I'm going to show you and put this totally out of context and making statements that are not, in my humble opinion, defendable. First statement, there is a conspiration out there that companies are engineering grains to make them more toxic. So that's the reason why we have these epidemics of the situation that we're facing. I'm not an agronomer. I mean, most of you guys know much more than I do about this. But the way that I understand, talk with my colleagues agronomers, it's been an evolution, genetically speaking, the grains, measured in millennia, not in years. The Greeks and Romans used to eat this grain over here, 14 chromosomes, 50,000 genes, not good heal in terms of what you can get out of that. It took a few hundred years in middle age that we went to the second reiteration, which pretty much we had this turgidum, double the chromosome, 100,000, and that's pretty much what our friends like Dante was using to eat at that time. Renaissance, so 400 or 500 years ago, made the final reiteration in which we had the modern TSTivum that was really the mix of these two, 150,000 genes. That this never changed in the past 4 or 5 centuries, for what we understand. And this has been done over the years, checking cultivars and the genetic cultivars in a very, very scientifically appropriate way. So the statement that in the past 40, 50, 60 years there have been a genetic engineer of grains is not substantiated by the facts. True, again, the grains were different. This is a beautiful painting in the 1500. Look how tall was the wheat. It's true, you know, we were a little bit shorter at that time, but you know, again, you know, what is happening now that wheat is shorter, we're a little bit taller, and matter of fact, now, 1/3 of the plant can give the seeds that is the heel that, you know, makes wheat so popular nowadays. But after that, there's been no change whatsoever. But what is so special about gluten? First of all, when we talk about gluten, we talk a mixture of proteins, namely gliadins and glutenins, both toxic for people with celiac disease. When you take, you know, wheat flour and you mix with yeast and water, you really unleash these, you know, substances, these proteins. Glutenins, they make this sort of fibers here that you see that create these little, you know, chambers in which this blob of gliadin will sit. But also, when you put, again, yeast and water, and you produce by fermentation gas, that's where the gas entrapped. And that's the reason why you can make a dough that will puff. And therefore, you can make this beautiful croissant that we have for breakfast, and the smelly bread, and the pizza like only Naples they can make, and the pasta. You got the point, in other words. Okay, you cannot do this with rice because you don't have these structures. And the organoleptic characteristics make wheat produce proteins, gluten, so unique is its elasticity. It's very elastic that no other proteins can do. That's the beauty. Where is the beast? This is the only protein that we cannot completely digest. Proteins can be compared to a sort of pearl necklace, each pearl being a component that we call amino acid. In order to make use of proteins, we need to cut this pearl necklace in pieces that we call peptides, and then we peel this, you know, amino acid one at a time, because all the amino acids can be absorbed by the intestine, and then we can make out of it either energy or remount this amino acid base out to our own program to make our own proteins. By the way, am I too technical? Are you sure? Sure. Otherwise, I start from the beginning. It's not going to happen. Okay. Well, we can do this process with all proteins but this one here. We as a species indeed did not evolve to eat gluten. Gluten came with agriculture only 10,000 years ago. So for the 2.5 million of evolution, humankind has been gluten-free for the vast majority of the time. The enzymes to break gluten down are not present for us. And this is due because this very peculiarity composition, this protein, is extremely rich in two amino acids, proline and glutamine. And we don't have the scissors, i.e. the digestive enzyme, to completely dismantle that. Now, say that, also I have to say, the enemies that the immune system see and eventually fights are proteins, what we call non-self antigens. So when you have undigested peptides, this can create problems. Matter of fact, in color-coded mode, I show you some of undigested peptides of what they do. This guy here can induce cell death, i.e. apoptosis. This guy here, it's what they call a super antigen. So unleash an exaggerated immune response with an exaggerated collateral damage inflammation that is not proportional to the danger that this peptide can give. These two guys communicate with the epithelial cells to release a molecule that we call zonulin that makes the intestine leak, helping gluten to come through. And this guy, this last guy here, will eventually produce chemicals that will call on the battlefield soldiers that are called neutrophils, setting the stage for inflammation. That is the fact. And this happened in everybody. And this has been taken totally out of context to the people that sustain that if we don't go gluten-free, the entire species will be extinct in the next generation or so. Okay? Why this is not the case? Well, again, I don't want to go too much in technical details, but these are the facts. The epithelial events, the ones that happen in a few hours, are pretty much events that we all go through. So you eat gluten, it's not completely digested. Some of these fragments will release this molecule that makes intestinal leak. This molecule will come over here, and at that point, the immune system sees the enemy to come in and clean it up. We don't know that this is happening. And the vast majority of the people, they go through this. Now, why this is all happening, we don't know for sure. The more we study what gluten does when it's ingested, the more we become convinced that mistakenly, because we didn't evolve to eat with this molecule, is interpreted like a component of a microorganism, i.e. a bacterium. And the immune system deploys the same weaponry that will deploy when it's under attack to a bacteria. Now, is that a rare event? Oh, no. As you will see toward the end of this chat, we are immersed by bacteria. This fight happens all the time between us and the bacteria. Very, very few times we lose this battle and we develop infections. Very few times. But this battle happens all the time and actually seems to be useful for what we call antigen sampling. So in other words, to bring antigen here so the immune system can eventually be aware of what is out there and induce tolerance, i.e., this is a friend, I want this friend to be here. I don't need to deploy anything, okay? Now, as we have the same understanding of the bacteria and our interaction with the bacteria, the same happens with gluten. This fight happens all the time in everybody. Very few of us will lose the battle. And these are the people that are predisposed to develop the gluten-related disorders, starting with this new entity that we call non-celiac gluten sensitivity. First steps are the same. You eat this, partially indigested. We release zonulin, increase permeability, we come here. Now you're genetically skewed to develop now an immune response that creates an exaggerated inflammation that can lead to symptoms that are typical of this condition. And this is the one that we see here in green. How many people that have that? We don't know. We will revisit that just in a moment, but this is a work in progress. Finally, if you are in this third stage here, in which now not only you eat gluten, you have this event everybody experienced. Not only you have an innate immune response, but now there is another branch of the immune system that is engaged, what we call the adaptive immune response. Now you have a chain of events that leads to destruction of the intestine that characterizes celiac disease. 1% of the general population isn't here. Okay? So the vast majority is here. We don't know here, but probably few percentage and 1% here. This is factual. What the other people say, well, because of this, everybody will be in trouble. And that's not factual. One of the most amazing discovery in the past 2-3 years about, you know, autoimmunity in general, and celiac disease in particular, is that we are not born with a destiny to develop this condition. So the old paradigm was, you are genetically predisposed to develop celiac disease, diabetes, breast cancer, stroke, Alzheimer, that's destiny. Sooner or later, you're going to get there. Not true anymore. Not true. That is the genetic predisposition. If this would translate in factual disease, depends on other stuff, and I'm afraid that you guys are responsible to stop this epidemics, and I'll tell you in a moment why. This is factual. In the past 50 years, we see in industrialized countries this epidemics, this unbelievable rise of MS, Crohn's disease, type 1 diabetes, asthma, and at the same time, in the same timeline, there was this drop in infections coming down. And that led to the hygiene hypothesis. Do you know what is the hygiene hypothesis? Do I need to go in details? Everybody's tuned in?
No.
No, okay. Without going too much in specific, once upon a time, there was something that was called backyard. Backyard? That was the place where kids used to play. When you were in the backyard, you would put your hands down to the, you know, the dirt, and then your mouth, then the dirt, scratch your butt, then the dirt, then your mouth. That really trained tremendously well the immune system for the wealth of enemies out there. And we were protected against autoimmunity. Now that we not have the backyard anymore, the backyard is the couch, and then we have the, I don't know what they call this, video games, some box something. That's the backyard of our kids. They are not putting anything in the dirt, and if they are really even thinking to sneeze, mom and dad will come with the sanitizer before that had happened. We don't have that training of the immune system anymore, and this leads us to more susceptibility to autoimmunity. So this is, in a nutshell, the theory of the hygiene hypothesis. This was also based that in countries in which kids still play outside, i.e. 95% of the world, so the developing countries, they don't see this. And that's the reason why the hygiene hypothesis came as a theory. Now this hygiene hypothesis is shaking as a theory. Why? Because some of these countries, developing countries, they have increased hygiene. For example, South America, like some parts of Brazil, Argentina, Chile, or North Africa, like Egypt and Morocco, there's much more hygiene than before, yet they don't see this. They see this if these kids or these people, they move to industrialized countries where they start to have the same kind of trend there. So what is driving this, you know, epidemics? This is a landmark study that, again, we as a center, you know, concluded only 10 years ago. This flag planted the flag celiac disease on the North American soil, in which, you know, we said is not rare, 1 in 10,000, as was believed. It's 1% like everywhere else, okay? And surprise, this was mesmerizing. You know, almost, you know, 10 years later, in 2010, we published a paper that is a nonsense, i.e. that like any other immune diseases, celiac disease also is on the rise. And this was not understandable because the premises was you're born with gluten or with the genetic predisposition to celiac disease, you eat gluten when baby food is introduced, that's when the autoimmune process starts. If you develop as a child, it's because the immune system is so aggressive that puts you over the edge right away. If you develop an adult, it's because the immune system is more slow-paced, and therefore the critical mass of damage that puts you over the clinical edge will happen later. That was the premises. With this study that followed 3,000 healthy individuals over the time of 50 years, celiac disease doubled every 15 years. There were people that were eating the undisputable trigger gluten, or celiac disease, gluten, for many years. Two ladies almost for 70 years with no problem whatsoever. And then all of a sudden, something happened to them. They lost their capability to tolerate gluten, and they developed celiac disease. So, yes, you need genes. Yes, you need gluten. But that's not sufficient. Something else needs to be in the recipe to develop celiac disease and probably other autoimmune diseases. So the two key questions that really pose these new observations are, what kind of tricks these two ladies have been using to tolerate what is the undisputable trigger autoimmunity? Imagine the power that we will have in our hands if we learn how they did that. So we can use the same strategy to prevent many immune-mediated diseases, not just autoimmunity, probably many others. Well, who is going to figure out this? Definitely will win the Nobel Prize. That's not going to be here, so forget about that. So, but what about the second? What happened to them that caused the shift from tolerance to immune response? So what made them to lose their luxury? So in other words, how can we rewrite the natural history of celiac disease? So people, they start to really pose some questions here. Is the quality of gluten is changing? And we said that's not the case. The quantity of gluten, maybe that we eat more. Breastfeeding, we do not breastfeed as we typically did. The time of the introduction of gluten, there was this theory, this tolerance window theory that says any kind of antigen, including gluten, if introduced between 3 and 7 months of age, will decrease the chance to have a negative outcome. Because if you introduce too early or too late, the immune system is not ready to really tolerate whatever, in this case gluten, and therefore you are in trouble. And again, other stuff and so on and so forth, that we really focus on these three elements here, doing a master study in which we took 700 infants at risk for celiac disease and we followed for 10 years. And this paper was just published a few weeks ago in New England Journal of Medicine, and a lot of paradigm went out of the window with tremendous dismay. And another lesson learned, by the way, there are no paradigms. There are not rules that cannot be broken in science in general and in medical science in particular. So do not hold too cozy with your ideas, because sooner or later they will be really put in the trash. And I tell always to my students and my fellows, when you say something, use always the conditional. Could be, maybe, probably, because otherwise you will be really faced with embarrassment if you are too assertive. So what we learned from this study, this window of tolerance crash does not exist anymore. It's not true. Matter of fact, kids that they had the gluten postponed later, they had merely a delay of the onset of the disease, but the disease happened anyhow, but there was no increase. With our major surprise, breastfeeding that we were sure would be protective was not. So breastfeeding, of course, is good for so many other things, but definitely if you breastfeed while introduce gluten, or you introduce small amount of gluten while breastfeeding early in life, that would not prevent celiac disease. Same outcome. GI infections, it's a mistake, seems to be influential. So in other words, if you have infection the first year of life, that will increase your risk to develop celiac disease. Among all the stuff, the only positive things that we found was genetics counts a lot. You have Joe Schmo out there, 1%. You are first degree relative, 10%. But if you're a first degree relative and you have two copies of one of these HLA that I was telling you before, in other words, you're homozygous for HLA DQ2, your chance to develop celiac disease can go as high as 40%. 40%. So genetics is the only thing that really counts. So with all this going to the trash, what else? This became a big deal. Microbiome composition. And you guys have a tremendous amount of responsibility here to really stop these epidemics. What I mean for that? This is a theory that we put forward 5 years ago when we start to see this inconceivable outcome of our study. Nutrition. Among all the influential elements that can change the microbiota composition is the key element. True, we use a lot of antibiotics. True that we use a lot of there are infections. True that the C-sections delivery is much more popular than in the past. True we travel a lot and therefore we live in a different world. But nutrition, among all the elements, is the most influential to shape our microbiome. After all, this is an ecosystem, a part of civilization that live in our guts, and they need to eat. And they are fed the leftover what we put in our mouth. The other thing that now is becoming extremely clear is the microbiome that will really shape the function of our immune system. And this happened the first 3 years of life. And then after that, the game is over. So if the microbiome is shaped by nutrition to be friendly with us, the immune system will have a more, quote-unquote, tolerogenic attitude. We stay more in peace with us. and when under attack will fight and point the weapons against the proper enemy, i.e. the dangerous signal come from the environment. If, on the other hand, we shape the microbiome in a way that the maturation of the gut-associated lymphoid tissue, so in other words, the immune system that lives in the gut, in an inappropriate way, we will have a much more belligerent, you know, immune system that, together with genetic predisposition, can lead us to immune-mediated diseases. Not in childhood. Not in childhood. Every age. A wrong microbiome with a wrong maturation of gut-associated lymphoid tissue can bring you to Alzheimer's when you're in the 70s. That as much as we understand right now. So why we came up with this theory? Why people that believe that? Well, guess what? We know that we are absolutely the dominant species on the face of the earth. And that was a fact. The reason why we are here and not chimpanzees, as this meaning means something, because we are better than that. However, when the Human Genome Project was completed, we learned the unthinkable. The unthinkable. Genetically speaking, we are not in the middle. We are at the very, very bottom of the genetic evolution. There, anything else on the face of the earth, genetically, is much more sophisticated than we are. Who is a fisherman here? Who go fishing? Do you use worms to go fishing? 90,000 genes. 90,000 genes. We have 25,000. So more than three times the genes that we have, the worm that we go fishing. The plant that make gluten, wheat, I told you, 150,000 genes. How we can really be at the bottom of the genetic evolution and be at the top as a dominant species? How is that possible? And how we can explain the inexplicable? The only way is that we have to accept that we are the combination of a two ecosystem, us and this bacteria that live with us. I know, because you can read this on the magazine when you go to your air cavity and so on and so forth, that we are made more than bacteria than us. There are 10 bacteria per each cell of our own body, that the bacteria collectively produce 100, 150 times more genes than we do, and so on and so forth. So bottom line, what I'm trying to say, that we are made by two genomes. The human genome that intrinsically comes from our parents, and if there is a mistake of the human genome, so that there are genes that put you at risk for any disease, let's say celiac disease, they're there. You can't trade in. That's it. But the fact that they're there doesn't mean that they will be functional to lead to the outcome that they can encode for. If they do or do not, depends on this other guy, the microbiome that is much more dynamic, they change from individual to individual, change the same individual over time, if we are lucky, come from mom. I will be inherited from our mother. Why? Because if the microbiome of our mother live in peace with her genes, probably will live in peace with our gene. And matter of fact, if you're born by C-sections in which you don't inherit it from mother, but from the environment, the chance that you develop celiac disease is four or five times more than if you inherited the microbiome from our mother through vaginal delivery. All this is fantasy? Well, it's a work in progress for sure, but it's factual. And this is a paper that we published recently as a proof of concept that brought us to this conclusion. The human genome can be compared to a sort of piano with roughly 25, 30,000 notes, one for each genes. It's stable. You bought the piano, you can't read it anymore. And if there are notes that if you strike that notes, you play the song Celiac Disease, so to be. But these notes are not necessarily played all the time. If they do or do not are played depends on the piano player, that is the microbiome. So if you have vaginal delivery birth, if you don't take antibiotics first year, if you're breastfed and so on and so forth, you may have the vaginal, the friendly microbiome, let's say, you know, Elton John, that touched two of the 300 notes that are necessary to play the song Celiac Disease, so you don't have it, even if you're genetically predisposed. Then you have an infection, you take antibiotics, you take the triple to Cancun and got drunk over there, anything that eventually can change the microbiome, and now maybe that Chopin is sitting. It's much more virtuoso. He touched all 300 notes, and now you play the song Celiac Disease at any age, because this can happen at any age. So now the inconceivable start to be conceivable. Also, the fact that there's not 100% concordance in identical twins was inconceivable. How can be? They both eat gluten, they both have the identical genes, the recipe is there, 75% concordance. 25% there was this coincidence. One twin got celiac disease, the other one got not. Probably this is the reason why. And we can listen to the music. When these two worlds that work together, metabolic pathways are activated. So if you look at some metabolic pathway, you see there is pop music playing. You know there is the friendly microbiome. You are not in trouble. But if you start to hear classic music, you know that the piano player changes. And you know that this can lead over time to bad outcome. So I'm going to finish up with this other interesting story. How are we doing with time? Okay. So again, the paradigm was you got sick when you eat gluten, you have celiac disease. Is celiac disease ruled out? You have no business to go on a gluten-free diet. That was the paradigm until the recent past. Then the inconceivable happened. Do you know, guys, Google Trend? No, neither did I. Anyhow, my young son, that now is 15, introduced me to this concept that, you know, you can do Google Trend. He was looking at the trend of the length of the skirt of the girls in the United States over time. What are you doing? Anyhow, so bottom line, he told me that you can check over time any kind of phenomenon. And I was a little bit more scientifically factual in looking at three popular diets, low-carb diet in orange, a fat-free diet, and a gluten-free diet. Here we are at less than $100 million of market. Note the scale here, 2004. We're not talking about, 1144 or 1844. 2004 was non-existent, okay? And then all of a sudden, this increasing popularity crossed the line in 2008, never looked back. It's by far the most popular diet ever in the United States. So we're talking about something of, epidemic proportions. Forget about the paleo diet, the South Beach diet, North Beach, West Beach, and so on and so forth. This is by far the most popular diet. And that led to the concept, there gotta be a fat component in it, and no question there is a fat component. Why? Because when you have icons like Lady Gaga that wants to lose yet another 15 pounds and said, I go gluten-free so I can lose another 15 pounds. Or, Oprah say, I'm going to cleanse my body by going gluten-free. What do I know? I'm in her book club. I'm going to go for it. I'm sorry. It's unfair, but I really don't like, her show. But I'm glad that it's not on anymore. Okay. But the point that I'm trying to make, look at this staggering number, the estimated gluten-free retail market. I mean, I wish when we start this, campaign that I bought some stocks in this market. I mean, we're talking about, something that is in the $1 billion. Now, depending on the estimate, it's 2, 5, 10 billion, doesn't matter. It's a huge amount of money that we're talking about. And the trend is amazingly, upward. This is only 2 years of 2011 in violet here and green in 2013. Anything is growing by the rate of 10, 15, 20% a year. What the heck is going on? Who are these people? And this is the most amazing factual evidence that I found online, Google. Google is telling me that it's very factual. That by 2013, 100 million people consumed a gluten-free product. In 2000, one out of three Americans consumed the freaking gluten-free diet. Why they did that? And by the way, yes, there are some stuff that skew the statistic. Even if you take California out, where 95% are gluten-free, it's the same story. So how this is possible? Who are these people? That's another factual evidence that came from an internet interview for 18 and older. Roughly 50 million people, they go gluten-free because they believe it's healthier. So it will make you healthier. Now, again, if going gluten-free means that you go back to the basics and start to cook yourself and have your own garden in the back and do the stuff, maybe. But if this was the exception of gluten-free, the one that we have in mind, i.e. that I go to the supermarket and buy the gluten-free products, I don't think that could be considered healthier. The other thing that is interesting, another big chunk of people, they go gluten-free because they think that they can lose weight going gluten-free. And again, the reason why I believe, because that's why, because this gluten-free, and then there is the word diet. And with diet, is the acronym is, the click in the brain is diet means losing weight. Now, again, it depends what you're talking about. If you talk about naturally gluten-free, so you eat only fruits, vegetables, fish, meat, and so on and so forth, you can't go to McDonald's anymore, junk food is out of your business, you may eventually lose weight. But the people that increase the diet the way that they do right now, that's not the case. Even if the gluten-free products got much better, they are hypercaloric anyhow compared to the gluten-containing counterparts. So this, the drive force of the market is made by these two junk here. Now these last three categories, now we've got interesting stuff. Approximately 9 million people, or you know, they said that they have mainly GI symptoms that will not go away unless they go gluten-free. Another 7 million, they have mainly extra-intestinal symptoms that will not go away until they've got gluten-free. And there is another piece of the pie that I don't think that you can see. It's a line. 300,000 people, this is the ones that have celiac disease. This is the one that then definitely needs to be on a gluten-free diet. That is roughly 10% of the people with celiac disease. How frequent are these other forms of gluten reaction like gluten sensitivity? Well, that's another very factual evidence that I bring you from Google. Each line is a report, and I arbitrarily divide in low, medium, and high frequency. In the low frequency, there are, you know, evidence that come from Columbia University, our center, that place this less than 10%. At the other end of the spectrum, there are these two pearls that I'm not going to discuss about because I know there is somebody that will lecture us about this. That again, sustain that if we don't go gluten-free, the dinosaurs will come back and take over the world. So all this to say that, you know, this gluten-free diet consumers can be divided into two major categories. The one that they consume gluten-free for no medical necessity, these are the occasional consumers. These are the people that are not, have no business to go gluten-free. That's the vast majority. 90%+ probably are in this category. And then the ones on a medical necessity, in which there are three subcategories, with allergy, roughly 0.1%, 0.4% of the population, celiac disease, 1%, and then this gluten sensitivity, there are estimates around between 1% and 6%. So again, the minority of the population. What is gluten sensitivity? I'm coming to the end here because there is a lot of confusion here. I want you to really pay attention to what is the consensus of four meetings, not one, four, they came up with, because we don't know what the heck is this. So it's by exclusion criteria. You call somebody with gluten sensitivity, in those cases, a reaction to ingestion of gluten-containing grains with signs or symptoms in which both with allergy and celiac disease have been ruled out. So in other words, you eat gluten, you got sick, you take wheat allergy and celiac disease out of the equation. You take these people off the gluten and they feel better. You put gluten back and they gluten-containing grains and they got worse. We call these people right now gluten sensitivity. Why? Because we do not have biomarkers. There are no validated biomarkers. No matter what you read in the market, there is nothing. It's a work in progress. Okay. What kind of symptoms these people they have? Top of the line, stomachache. Then eczema, headaches. They have foggy mind. They can't think straight. If they ask you these people, who is your spouse? They say, no. chronic fatigue, diarrhea, depression, and so on and so forth. So, you know, symptoms that we see also in celiac disease. So this is not distinguishing from celiac disease. Another big confusion. Is gluten sensitivity, IBS, the same thing or different things? So there was a study from Australia. They did a double blind for this gluten sensitivity. They said, yes, gluten is the culprit. And they come up with numbers that goes all the way up to 20% of people with IBS may have gluten sensitivity, i.e. they can benefit going gluten-free. They came back and said, wait, we were wrong. It's not gluten in the grains that create this. Our FODMAPs that are creating the problem and create a tremendous confusion. Now, for you guys, it's a given, but this is the consensus of NIAID on terminology of food reaction. So I know, I'm sorry, this is redundant for you, but just make sure that we understand what you're talking about. What is food intolerance? It's a condition in which the body lacks of an enzyme or you eat too much of that nutrient that leads to symptoms. Classical example, lactose intolerance. You don't have lactase, the sugar is not digested, go to the colon, it's fermented, you produce gas, and with that, the symptoms with bloating, stomachache, and irregular bowel movements. FODMAPs is another food intolerance. Too many F stay for fermentable oligosaccharide that will reach the colon, same story, and so on and so forth. So with food intolerance in general, you have only GI symptoms. Nothing, no foggy mind, no joint pain, no skin rash. It's only and exclusively GI symptoms because of fermentation of the sugars. Food sensitivity, including gluten sensitivity, understudied error, immune-mediated, there is no immune involvement here, and the reaction of some nutrients, these reactions do not always occur in the same way when eating the particular nutrients. So today I have headache. The next time that I eat, I can have joint pain. And then the next time I have stomachache. So it can change over time. And then the food allergy, we know what it is, so I'm going to skip that. So when you take these gluten-containing grains out of the diet, you eliminate roughly 5% of the FODMAP intake. So in other words, you eliminate this. All this FODMAP stuff, polyols, lactose, excess fructose with fruits, honey, sweeteners, are still there. So bottom line, when you go gluten-free or you eliminate these grains, you eliminate a minuscule amount of FODMAP. So FODMAP cannot be the driving force of gluten sensitivity. I hope that we set this story straight. So to finish, the proposed classification of gluten-related disorders based on pathogenesis, autoimmune celiac disease with its permutation, allergy with its permutation, then non-autoimmune, non-allergic, probably non-immune gluten sensitivity. The caveat here is that we have biomarkers, i.e. way to diagnose this and this, not yet for gluten sensitivity. And there are some differentials between these three forms. For example, time interval between the introduction of gluten and the symptoms can be years here, minutes here, and in between. Gluten sensitivity can be hours and days, and then the pathogenesis and so on and so forth. The point that I want to make is that clinically they are not distinguishable. So you can't tell just in a clinical presentation if an individual has celiac disease, gluten sensitivity, with allergy. I want to leave you with another provocation here. There is a lot of stuff in there about the role of gluten in autism and schizophrenia and ADHD. This will take another 25 hours business, so I just drop the bomb and leave it. You heard that I wrote, with the help of many people at the center, this book. I don't like to write books. Specifically books for the lay people, because I don't think that I'm a good writer. I write a lot of articles and scientific books. The reason why I was forced to do that is mainly because I wanted to really set the record straight. This is factual. So again, if you have the chance to really make a strive for this book, parenthetically, I don't make zero money in this book because all the province, all the money will go to research, the Center for Celiac Research. This book was written to set the story straight, because now everybody's expert of gluten-related disorders. You really go out there, and if you look ugly, if sexually you're not good enough, if the Democrats that lost these terms is because of gluten. Now, here it's a little bit more factual. So I think that it was worth my 46. I'm sorry, I took 1 minute extra of sharing what is the fact, so that, again, we can set this meeting on the right pace. Thank you so, so much.
Thank you so much for sharing with us. So you said the answer is kind of in nutrition. What do you think, I'm a registered dietitian, what do you think we should be saying to people so we don't lead to that gluten sensitivity?
Actually, I want to go beyond gluten sensitivity. I really do believe that gluten sensitivity, all these other immune-mediated diseases are driven by the way that we eat. Again, if you just think that 2.5 generations ago, there was no refrigerator. So you have to produce and consume locally. If you think that my generation, I'm not that old. kind of am. We had strawberries July and August, nothing else. I was introduced to kiwi recently. I don't know what kiwi was. So in other words, we really eat different than we used to. For my daughter, cooking is to take the tray from the frozen section and ask to the box how long you got to be in that machine. It's called the microwave. And that's it. But what is in there is not known. So I don't pretend that we have to go back. I was telling the tiger, to the caveman lifestyle. But we can definitely look back not long ago and try to make adjustment to eat a little bit more healthy so that eventually we can reshape our microbiome in a way that will be more friendly with us.
Hi, at your center, are you studying how body clock disruption and sleep deprivation are affecting the gut and immunity?
So, you know, when you study, you know, biological phenomena, we tend to do the unthinkable, i.e. to take pieces like the GI tract and take this out of context. But we are made by an entire body. We know, for example, that the immune system can be influenced by many, many things. One is sleep deprivation. Personally, I'm not studying that, but a lot of people, they do. Other people, for example, study the effect of laughing on health, because laughing boosts the immune system, believe it or not. So again, all this to say, there are so many, there is a general scheme, it's a general team, how the story works, but there's a lot of stuff that can influence this team in terms of the outcome. So definitely there is a lot that we need to learn. And this will be happening only if we go back to the origin of what the medicine was. You know, at the beginning, doctors were healers. The focus was the patient. Then we focus on the disease with evidence-based medicine. Now we're going back to the patient, thank God, with personalized medicine. So all these effects of this permutation can have, you know, a more meaningful study so for the clinical outcome.
Hi, Dr. Fasano. I'm a huge fan of all your work. In fact, I think you just did a webinar, and I'm thinking it was from you, where you talked about the contamination in grains that should be naturally gluten-free. Was that your webinar? And, well,
I'm just thinking,
there was a study that came out of, like, last year, and it talked about, they did this study on grains like millet and beans, even, that you wouldn't think had gluten in them. They're naturally gluten-free. But when you test them, sometimes they're quite high in gluten contamination. So I know for your Fasano diet that you might, I don't know if you mentioned it in your book, you encourage people to like get everything out and like, and but what do you do about that? About the grains and beans that may be contaminated?
The bottom line here, and people that do this for a living, they know very well, it doesn't matter how you start. The product can be started with gluten containing grains. In other words, you can start the product with wheat. The problem is what you finish with. What is the final product at the end of the pipeline? So you can have wheat at the end, can be gluten-free, or you can start with rice and millet, and at the end you have gluten because it's cross-contaminated. So the key elements for these, the people that need to be strictly gluten-free, is really to eventually have a system of control of the product that comes on the market that is below the 20 parts per million. Now, the Fasano diet, that is an awful diet, so I don't know why Pam and her, my friends, they insist to call, you know, that I don't like my name, I've touched something nasty. But anyhow, it's only naturally gluten-free because some people, 10% of people with celiac disease, are not responsive to the gluten-free diet. So we call non-responsive celiac disease. The vast majority of them, they even react to the minuscule 20 parts per million. So going natural gluten-free, so only fresh fruit, vegetable, fish, meat, and so on and so forth for 3 months, is just to reset the immune system to be able then to go back and tolerate the minimal cross-contamination.
We're going to run over just a few minutes. We're going to take just the questions of the people that are standing, and then no more. So
quick
don't
question,
get up.
Quick answer, yeah. Because yeah. We have to give the time to the others.
Okay, just a quick question on how your study squared with the celiac epidemic that occurred in Sweden, which coincided with infant feeding recommendations and breastfeeding. It went up when it didn't coincide with breastfeeding, and it went down dramatically when it did.
Yeah, that was an unfortunate natural experiment that was done. And this still holds true. If you introduce gluten too early, that will increase the risk. If you introduce late, does not, because we figured out. So the window doesn't exist anymore. But if you introduce early, as they did with this quote-unquote 4-5 formulin, which between 2 and 4 months they add gluten in there, you go from 1 to 9%. And when they retired the formula from the market, it went back to 1%. So we know too early in large amount is not a good thing.
Has any of your studies gone into the effects of external, such as pesticides and treatments of wheat and grain on the biogene?
That's right. So I think that this is an extremely important question. I don't feel qualified to answer to that. I know, for example, that now we introduce, maybe that we're here during this day, more wheat from countries like China. We don't know what they put on this wheat, if the pesticides will really have a negative impact on the immune system. All this is possible. So in other words, the epidemics can be driven by factors that are not genetically, you know, determined by the changes of the cultivar, rather what is on it. That's entirely possible. But again, I don't think that I am qualified to really to give you an intelligible answer. Hopefully, you know, somebody more qualified will tell us if this is factual or not.
Hi there. Do you recommend that folks who believe they are gluten intolerant be have celiac ruled out?
Oh, absolutely. It's a must. You saw in the definition of gluten sensitivity, we don't call intolerance, again, to avoid the confusion with intolerance, that wheat allergy and celiac disease needs to be ruled out before that you try the gluten-free diet. Otherwise, that would be extremely confusing.
Probiotics?
Probiotics.
We said keep the questions brief. Yes.
That's right. Now, this would take an entire, not hour, but a consensus conference. Well, let me put it this way. I really do believe that probiotics, they hold tremendous potentials. But I also believe that we're making with probiotics the same mistakes that we made with antibiotics. When penicillin was discovered by Fleming, we thought that this was the panacea to treat all the infections. And we know what that we've done by this promiscuous use of antibiotics. The same applies for probiotics. I think that there will be a powerful tool to really reshape the microbiome to be more friendly with us. But again, not a single probiotic will work for everybody. It needs to be customized. So we are not quite there yet to have the technicality to study the specific dysbiosis, i.e. imbalance the microbiome, that then can be treated with a customized probiotic, because that will work. But if we just give probiotics like this, chance exists that we're going to vilify something that can be potentially important. So thank you so much, guys. Appreciate it.